Hi there, I'm Kristen Horner Warren, and the purpose of this video series is for you to learn just a little bit more about the physiology of both acute and chronic pain. And, you know, many people don't realize this, but there's actually a large body of scientific evidence to show that just the act of learning about pain is therapeutic. And part of the reason for that is by understanding pain, automatically, when you understand pain, it becomes much less overwhelming, it becomes less frightening. And so the science shows that actually learning about pain, participating in what scientists call therapeutic neuroscience education, is linked very strongly to decreased physical symptoms, to improved function, to reduced fear, to improved mobility, and just a calmer nervous system overall. So that is the purpose of this series of videos, is to give you some of those benefits. So let's just launch right into it. So fundamentally, at its very essence, the purpose of pain is to motivate behavior change. Now, pain motivates you to avoid things that either are harmful or have the potential to be harmful. It forces you to take the steps necessary in order to heal from injury. It gives you very strong incentive to avoid making the same mistake twice. And if pain were not so unpleasant, it wouldn't be so effective as a tool for motivating behavior change. You know, life entirely without pain is not safe. There's a very, very rare condition that causes people to feel no pain. And those people do not live for very long. And so we need pain in this physical experience in order to stay safe in our bodies. Now, this is a depiction of both the peripheral and central nervous system. The peripheral nervous system being the nerves that are out in your body in the periphery, the central nervous system being made up of the brain and the spinal cord. And it is these two systems cooperating with one another that are involved in the creation and the experience of pain. And so, like we said a minute ago, pain is a warning signal. It is a warning signal that is intended to motivate behavior change. And so there's lots of warning signals in our body. We have the warning signal of fatigue, which motivates us to rest, hunger, which motivates us to eat, thirst, that tells us that we need to drink, and pain, which is needed to motivate us to change our behavior in order to allow for healing. But most people have a tendency to assume that pain is sort of like a burglar alarm, in the sense that, a burglar alarm alerts you with a siren when a burglar has broken a window, or when there's a fire in your basement, or something like some sort of emergency situation like that, but it stays silent all the rest of the time. And so most people assume that the pain system is very similar to this, meaning that if people experience pain, they have a tendency to come to the conclusion that there's something terribly wrong with the body, that there's some sort of emergency that needs attending to. And so as a result, pain, the experience of pain, is very, very closely linked with the experience of fear. But modern neuroscience tells us that pain is actually much, much more complicated than just a simple burglar alarm system. And this is what we are going to talk about for the rest of this video and the next. So the experience of pain there's two things involved in the experience of pain, the perception of pain. The nerves that actually convey raw data from the body to the brain, and then the brain's interpretation of that raw data. And so it's really in the brain's interpretation that is where pain actually exists. So nerves have no capacity to feel the way that we think of feeling. All that nerves do is convey information to the brain, and the brain is where feeling actually takes place. So nerves convey raw data to the brain actually assembles that raw data and actually creates all sensory experience, including the sensory experience of pain. And so this is true, like I say, of all sensory experience, meaning that if you were to hold your hands over a flame, you experience the sensation of warmth in your hands, but in actuality, that sensory experience is taking place in the brain because that's where the data coming from your hands is being assembled into a sensory experience. Another example of this is the sense of sight. So we know that the sense of sight takes the data from our eyes, is assembled and interpreted in a portion of the brain called the occipital lobe in the back of the head. And we also know that if a person has either an injury to that part of a brain or a stroke or a tumor or something like that, that is affecting the part of the brain that receives that visual information, that person might become blind, might lose their sense of sight, even if their eyes are still functioning perfectly. And that's because sensations do not exist. They are not experienced at all if they are not processed by the brain, if they're not created by the brain. And there are absolutely no exceptions to this. So even though we hear a lot in casual language, even language from physicians in many cases, we hear people talking about pain nerves or pain signals or pain pathways. They're really, when we look at the physiology of the way that this system works, there are no pain nerves. There are no pain pathways. There are no pain signals. What there are, or what are called nociceptors. And so a nociceptor is a very specific type of nerve that communicates information about either change or potential threat from the body to the brain. And so they communicate change and threat, but not pain. So this is raw data that's streaming into the brain from the body by way of nociceptors. So there's all sorts of specialized nociceptors all over your body that communicate, each of them communicates a specific type of information. Information related to stretch and temperature and pressure and pH and inflammation, oxygen deprivation, all kinds of things. And this information is constantly streaming into your brain from your body, giving your brain practically an infinite amount of information about the current state of what's going on in the body. And these sensors, these nociceptors, millions and millions of them are scattered all over the body, through our joints, our muscles, ligaments, discs, everywhere in the body. And so these millions of receptors send literally trillions of bits of information to the brain. And so these messages are not pain. They're just raw data. And the brain takes the information from the nociceptors and processes it, makes an interpretation of it, and then determines whether or not pain is an appropriate or necessary response. And so the brain is taking these messages in, weighing these messages in the context of your situation and against information that's stored in your memory, and it may or may not create pain in response. And so the brain is playing an extremely active role in determining which of these bits of information to pay attention to and how to interpret this information. So just like when you hold your hands over a flame and you feel the sensation of warmth in your hands when it's actually taking place in your brain, and just like if a person has a head injury or a stroke or a tumor that's affecting the portion of the brain that processes visual information, they could become blind even if their eyes are functioning perfectly normally. All pain, and there are no exceptions to this, is made in the brain. And so this is a very, very important point to keep in mind. Pain is an output from the brain as opposed to an input to the brain. Now think about this. We tend to think of pain as coming from the body and going to the brain, when really in actuality, the brain is creating pain. The brain is, the pain is an output from the brain. And so, like I said earlier, pain is a warning signal. And so sometimes it's very obvious why a warning signal would be necessary or appropriate, such as, say for instance, when you break your leg and you need to rest in order to give that broken bone time to heal. So pain would be an appropriate response in this situation. It would be a warning signal, the need to rest so that you can heal. But we know, again, from modern neuroscience, and also just from personal experience, if you really think about it, that matters are a lot more complicated than that. That pain is actually really not at all an accurate measure of tissue health. So, one example of this was an article that I came across a few years ago that was accompanied by this photo. And what it said in the article is that this Chinese man had actually climbed 5 flights of stairs to get to the emergency department with this knife stuck in his skull, literally lodged in his brain, and he was not experiencing any pain at all. So that would be an example of a lack of clear relationship between tissue injury and pain. Here's another example. This is my son a few seasons ago playing high school football, and the actual moment of impact wasn't quite captured in this photo, but it came really close. My son, who's number 7 in the red jersey here, was running full speed toward the end zone with the football. The opposing team player was running full speed in the opposite direction, and the opposing team's player's helmet collided with my son's shin. And it was amazing when this happened. We were in this big stadium. We live in Texas, and so high school football stadiums are big places. And as this collision took place, it actually just like reverberated through the stadium. It made this loud crack, and everyone in the stadium sort of went, oh, like there was this audible kind of reaction to this injury. And my first thought was, oh my goodness, we are going to the emergency room. Something really catastrophic has happened to my son's leg. But he, after the play was over, popped right back up off the turf, jogged off the field. I could see as he was running toward me that there already was this growing goose egg on his shin. It was already all black and blue. It got worse as the evening went on, but he experienced actually absolutely no pain whatsoever, which is really strange because every time I've whacked my shin on anything, not even when it hasn't been nearly as hard as this, I have found it excruciatingly painful. Now, my first thought was that this was just teenage bravado, a kid who was being tough because he didn't want to show any kind of vulnerability on the football field. But it was really interesting because over the next several weeks, where he continued to have this big swollen goose egg on his shin, it never hurt. So that's an example of some fairly significant tissue injury that was accompanied by no pain whatsoever. Another example of that would be the fact that there's lots and lots of science to suggest that it is possible to have even very extensive age-related degeneration of the spine without any pain at all. If you were to take people off the street, people who had no back pain at all, and do MRIs on them, you would find, according to science, that by age 65, nearly 100% of them would have some sort of significant degeneration to their spine, including bulging discs, herniated discs, ruptured discs, bone spurs, extensive arthritis. And it's, so this would be nearly 100% of people over the age of 65, even people with no pain whatsoever. And they have found actually even 3/4 of people, even in, as young as in their 20s, have some evidence of degenerative changes to their necks when examined on MRI, even though they have no pain. So those are a few examples of situations where there is, in fact, tissue injury, tissue pathology, tissue degeneration, and no pain. And it goes the other way around, too. It is possible to have even relatively minor tissue injury and severe pain. So you probably had the experience at one time or another of walking across your house in the dark at night and stubbing your toe on a piece of furniture that your spouse left in the wrong place, or stepping on a toy that your child left on the floor and having severe pain. This has happened to me a few times where I thought I was gonna barf. The pain was so severe. And in actuality, the tissue damage to my foot didn't even look like this. I didn't even get black and blue. It was just a minor bump, but it felt awful. It hurt a lot. And the most compelling example of the fact that it's possible to have even very, very severe pain is in the case of people who have had amputations and have phantom limb pain. You know, science suggests that nearly 80% of people who have had amputations have some degree of phantom limb pain. And in some cases, this pain is really, really severe. And so in this case, it's not just that there's minimal injury to the tissue, it's that there's no tissue there at all, and it's still causing pain. So this is very good evidence to suggest that the relationship between tissue health and tissue pain is not a direct relationship. It's a complicated relationship. So if tissue health isn't the factor that determines whether or not we have pain, then what is that factor? And that is going to be the topic that I'm going to discuss in the next video. So please stay tuned.